Progress comes to a world of magic as science and the arcane combine to make marvels. Meet steampunk inventors and orc mystics at the Wolsung Hub on beastsofwar.com. Become a general of mighty armies at the Kings of War Hub. Take command of elves, dwarves, and orcs in this game of masked fantasy combat on beastsofwar.com.
Hello and welcome to the Weekender. It's Saturday morning.
Morning.
Right. You have been going at us saying, oh, we love having Ben on the show, but he's in that tiny little window. You can hear him. You can hear him. And then when he's in the tiny window, we don't like Ben small, but then when Ben's big, what we're looking at on screen is really small. We want to be like TV.
Want a happy medium of everything.
Yeah. Ah,
the ghost of Ben.
The ghost of Ben. Bring him up.
Ta-da!
There we go. Hey, Ben. How are
you?
Hello. Okay. Basically, we have taken another step forward, okay?
Yeah.
In terms of the production of the show. We are now up to about 40,000 buttons that we have to press during the process of making a show.
Yeah, and my blood pressure's up.
Yeah. So we are sitting here like three Cylons, wom wom, wom wom, pressing all of our buttons and stuff like that. We've put in a new kind of a thing to allow us to have Ben big.
Yeah.
Ben plus what we're looking at on screen.
Yeah.
What we're looking at on screen on its own, and then a zoomed in version of what we're looking at on the screen, and then back to Ben big again. So,
sorcery.
Yeah. Can I just say, right? It's going to take us a while to get used to all of this because we just have so many buttons and bits and pieces all connecting it together. And it's all held together with sticky tape, every bit of it.
Gaffer tape.
I can now tell you. I believe we have now reached the limit of our technical capabilities based on any reasonable budget that a little outfit like ours is ever expected to achieve.
I tell you this. I remember the last time we did a show where someone had a screen in front of them was Tourniette.
Yes.
And I remember Lloyd doing Tourniette, building the show as he went at some point.
Yeah.
Just because he was so frantic, because you would start calling on stuff that he hadn't even prepped for.
Yes, yes. Well, the beauty of all of this is all of this has been put in place to work on a live stream scenario, because sooner or later we're gonna bring you a show live, and then we'll have all the tweeters and things like that all back on the show.
All right.
But really, this, we're hacking now. We are really, really hacking stuff together that was never designed to go together.
Bodge. It's a true engineering bodge.
It is. We are bodging like mad. Honestly, if this doesn't get us there, the next thing that will get us there is going to cost $100,000 minimum, maybe $1 million, because we literally cannot do any more than what we are technically doing now. We've reached that upper limit. Yeah. Moore's law no longer applies to Beasts of War. Okay. Moore's law, Justin. Well, I'm glad you asked.
I've not heard of it.
I'm glad you asked. Moore's law.
Okay.
Back in the 50s. Uh-huh. Okay, they had started to develop computer processors, right? Mm-hmm. And Moore,
yes.
Okay, I think he was. It might have been Roger Moore, or Pete Moore, or Moore.
Looking skeptically at Warren here.
But anyway, Dr. Moore.
Yes.
Observed that processors were doubling in speed every 18 months.
Okay.
Okay. So he made a prediction that this would continue.
So there'd be a bell curve, yeah?
No. It's like that.
Oh, right. So, just,
every 18 months,
right,
that computer processors would double in speed.
Okay.
So what happened was, it was more of a Moore's prediction rather than a Moore's law.
Okay.
But it became a law because Intel and AMD and all these boffins,
right,
who are working on computer processors, pushed to try and make this happen. They became obsessed with Moore's law. So
okay.
What happened was, more and more gates were being squeezed onto computer processors.
Uh-huh.
The size of these gates, so they came down, you know, into nanometer scales
so
and things like that.
As small as you can put it with an electrical charge running through without it crossing over.
Yes, you know, they were fiddling with atoms in a lot of this stuff now. But as well as this week being the week that Beasts of War can no longer adhere to Murr's scale in terms of Murr's law, in terms of the production of the show,
yeah.
Although I'm sure we could get better at using the equipment.
well, you could clone me.
Also, Murr's law in computing science has died as well now. It's right. Now no longer applies because the latest Intel chips and things like that, they don't believe are going to be able to double in their processing capacity.
Right.
Because we are now literally reaching the final, reaching the minimum viable kinds of limits on how small we can actually make
An actual circuit
gates
transfer,
and stuff
yeah.
like that in computer chips. So yeah. And you know, the other thing you will have noticed is we're all on multi cores.
Right.
So by adding more cores, we were able to double it. But that, you know, that's going to increase the size of the chips. Now, although I'd read we're now at the limit of Murr's law, I have this sneaking suspicion that we're not. I think that the drive and the addiction that the guys have within that industry
right.
is too much, and I think that they will continue to do it for some foreseeable time.
Right.
Because there are other things, like there's graphene, which is the new wonder material.
Right.
It'll be a while before we're painting it onto our miniatures, although I have been using it on gun barrels and tank barrels for a long time.
What?
Because graphene is literally just one atom layer thick of a pencil.
Oh, okay.
So, do you know any time that you guys have been running pencils along the edges of your tanks to give it that kind of shiny worn yeah. effect? What you've actually been doing is playing with graphene.
Okay.
Well, at least I like to think so.
Okay.
At least I like to think
well,
so.
I
so, anyway.
I did
so,
see a thing recently where there's a 1.4 million year crystal storage device now.
Ooh, or backups. Yes. So, we've been talking about we have a backup problem here at Beasts of War, we have an archive problem. We have 140 terabytes of stuff that we can't afford to lose. So there's 140 terabytes, and there's no weekenders in it whatsoever because we don't archive the weekenders.
Well, we archive the finished render, but it's
small. It's tiny. We're not archiving the projects. A typical Beast of War project for a painting tutorial or a hobby lab could be upwards of 200 gig just for the project files.
You're looking closer to 250, 300 once he's done waffling on.
So if you're a backstager, you'll notice on Beasts of War we're putting up videos about how we back stuff up.
Yeah.
Lo and behold, this week, some other boffins have invented Superman crystals that you can put 360 terabytes of information onto, and it'll last for 14 billion years.
There you go.
Right now, we've been looking at hard disks, Ben, that we expect to last for 2 years, and we have to spin up every year and recopy the files to.
Yeah.
But they've created these Superman crystals, and this is what we always wanted. Yeah. All we ever wanted was crystals that we could just pop into a hole and it do what it need to do, and we are now finally there. If you are one of those boffins, there's a very good chance you are, because boffins love wargaming, and we love you. We love you a lot.
Yeah.
Can you help us out? You know, can we get one of these Superman crystals, and we can put Beast of War on a Superman crystal and then blast it up in a rocket? Right? Imagine that. Imagine getting the Beast of War stuff.
Are you talking about sending our entire library into space?
Yes.
But what aliens found that?
Exactly, Ben.
That would be interesting. Welcome to Earth.
We'd be amazing ambassadors for Earth.
Me as an ambassador to an alien species.
You think about it. They come here after watching Beasts of War.
Right.
They will perfectly understand the nuances of a good Willy joke.
I'll give you that. I will give you that.
Right. We have a show to get on with.
Yeah.
Benno.
Yes.
We've got a few updates on some of the content and stuff like that that's going on. What can you tell us?
Cool. So the first thing is, this week, continuing his series, we have Uncle Jimmy and Oriskany. They've been doing their Force on Force series, which is sort of a modern combat game by Ambush Alley and Osprey Games.
Mm-hmm.
And in this second part, he's been talking a little bit about sort of the way that morale works, because everything in Force on Force is all very much about asymmetry. It's something that we've talked about before on the Weekenders. And it's interesting to see how the morale works for these different squads and things like that, with their sort of the levels and things, and how like tight-knit units of small squads that have been highly trained can last against huge units of things.
Now, this is something that I'm really, really into, because for me, you know, asymmetrical wargaming is whenever you have a small number of forces against a larger amount of force. In other words, it's not this balanced wargaming that, that many of us are used to. But what it also means is that the win conditions can be quite different.
Yeah, and your table layout can be quite different as well.
It could be. It could be. But one of the things that really excite me about this Force on Force series is I have always wanted to see a really good moderns game, okay, that gives me the vibe of Full Spectrum Warrior. Do any of you guys remember playing Full Spectrum Warrior on
the
Xbox?
I do, yes. I had it on the Xbox.
Oh, Full Spectrum Warrior on the Xbox. You know, you were commanding a team of four guys, okay, your standard kind of U.S. Army unit, and you had to do bounding overwatches and things like that. You had to get them to provide suppression fire and stuff like that.
I think I remember you talking about this before now.
Amazing, amazing. And I think that Force on Force is very much designed around this, Ben, wouldn't you say?
Yeah. It is definitely. One of the things that Ariska and Uncle Jimmy brought up in the first article they did, which you can also see, this was the fact that it's all about the people behind the guns, not necessarily the weapons, and how their training impacts how they react on the battlefield and things like that, whether it be shooting or trying to save someone and things like that. So this seems like a very, very almost Full Spectrum Warrior in the sense that it's faithful representation of how modern combat works, really. So it'd be really interesting to see how this goes. There's two more parts planned out so far, so we'll see where it goes from here.
Okay, so how many parts are up at the moment? We've had part one, part two.
Part one and part two, yeah.
Part three's coming next week,
Part three's coming next week on Monday, and that's all about casualties and how soldiers deal with casualties in different ways, because obviously elite units deal with them very differently from sort of the built-in troops of rebels and things like that. And then part four is all going to be about vehicles and adding them to the game, and also support supplements and things like that, the backup force on force. So
awesome. So if you're into a bit of moderns, or you've kind of always wondered about the prospect of modern warfare on the tabletop, because we've done a lot of historical, we've done a lot of fantasy, we've done a lot of sci-fi.
Well, it brings up the question that we always have is, how close to present day is too soon to be actually covering certain wars?
Well,
you know, that's a thorny one that we've came up with a couple of times.
And that's a question for another Weekender.
That's fair enough.
So, okay, what else have we got on the cards, Ben?
Cool. So another thing that came up was a really fantastic sort of bodging series, I guess you'd call it, which was by Thomas Menes, who came in and I think he showed off an army at one point on the Weekender, I think.
He did, indeed.
Yeah. Well, he also filmed some really cool mashup videos where he shows you how he does some of these conversions. And the one that he did first off was using the Butcher from Kador and giving it a very interesting head swap.
This man's head here.
Yeah, my head, right there. I was quite happy with how this turned out. And your head was used as well.
Yes,
in a little bit of a Shakespearean pose.
Yeah. Well, this is part of a new mini-series that's done. And we asked Thomas whenever he was filming it to kind of get us the basics in place, because we have another three parts of this series to go up. A two-parter and another one-parter. And the final episode is immense. You know, he very, very quickly ramps up the tips and the technical capabilities.
When we had
and
him
stuff.
Here, he was going through boxes of stuff, and he just went this. Aha!
Yeah, it's a really, really good series. The first episode really does a good job of covering all the basics. So if you want to get into, understand better your options with conversions on metals and things like that there, it's a very, very good
episode.
Even
something as simple as being able to properly pin stuff.
Yes.
That's something that I've always avoided, because I have no confidence in myself to actually do it and do it right.
Yeah.
I can't do the same. I'm always afraid of
pinning. And actually miss where the hole should be on the other side, and then it's off. Instead of being where it should be.
So he provides all the tips and stuff on how to do that. Well, definitely worth checking out. We also this week had an article on photographing miniatures, yes. A slightly more advanced one, Ben, yeah?
Yeah, so we've had some discussion in the forum before about photographing miniatures and trying to get the best out of it, you know, pieces of paper and things like that, and, you know, setting up your room and things. But Carlos from Corvus Belli, who has been in with us to do loads and loads of filming for Infinity, did an article over on the Infinity website a while ago and decided to share it with us as well. So he gave mm-hmm. us permission to put that up. It's got some really nice pictures, some very well thought out sort of steps to go through when you're filming, photographing miniatures, sorry, and trying to get the best crisp details out and things like that. So
yeah, now this is all about using slightly more advanced kit. You know, you are talking about a digital SLR. You know, it's not about snapping minis with your phones. I believe.
Yeah.
You know, we have a backstage article, which is more of the kind of the basics of setting up your light box and stuff like this. This is an article we wanted to put out because it is taking that to a next level. Because, in my opinion, very few companies take as great photographs of yep. their miniatures as Corvus Belli.
Very you know, true.
The Infinity photography is just immense. They totally get that, and it was great to be able to nail Carlos down to say, well, you know, how specifically do you do that? Mm-hmm. We may do a follow up thing later in the summer, where we might actually have a go at it on video and actually show it on video and show you how it's done. But if you're interested in understanding the difference that a lens makes in how it can go from looking like you're photographing a miniature to you're actually photographing another sci-fi human being doing something awesome,
yeah,
this is the article to go and have a read of. Mm. Right, definitely. Also this week,
yeah,
me and Justin were...
We got our game on.
We did an amazing game of Wolsung. Like, I mean, it was awesome. It was
very cool.
Awesome.
With your favorite cool. types of jokes.
Yeah, and it's completely front stage. It's completely front stage. Bring it up there. Do we get a quick look at it?
Here we go.
So at the very top, you can do the whole play me everything that happened, and it'll play it one after the other.
Yep.
But it's in our kind of live blog format, and that's the way we do our battle reports, so as you can kind of get all the photography from the different phases of the game. Mm-hmm. And the plot line was brilliant. The plot line was utter brilliant. It's one that we've been working on for a while.
Yeah.
We basically wanted to have a distillery making moonshine. And myself, I was playing the Ashen Oak, fine tough fellows.
Well, I was playing the Scylla, legitimate businessman.
Little tiny mafioso boys.
Yeah, halfling mafia.
Have you got a picture of the table? Bring up the table. Do you see the table? The table
possibly.
Is great.
I'll see if I can get a decent shot of it here.
Okay.
I've got this, which I think will work quite nice. Uh-huh. So let's get rid of Ben.
Yes. So this is the table, right? Mm-hmm. This is the on the outskirts of Lyoness.
Yeah, in Balahi.
In Balahi. Yep, the village of Balahi. The market was on. Everybody ran away when they heard the gunfire. You can see the kind of in the warehouse there. That's where the still was. Mm-hmm. There's a couple of water towers because you need water and things like that for a still. And then there's this little rural office block where the Scala do all their business and count their money.
Well, hand. We don't just make moonshine out there. We also legitimately manage a few farmlands.
Yeah.
You know, it's all above board, I swear.
Sure they do. Anyway, the objective was to get into the warehouse. And when you get into the warehouse, then you had this opportunity to wake up the still. Mm-hmm. And then the still turned into a big, stompy robot.
Yeah, let's see if I can find it.
We're bound to have a picture of the big, stompy robot somewhere. There he is. There he is. Yep, on the roll of a 6, he activated, or a 5 or a 6,
yeah.
He activated, and then he started kicking my ass. It was brilliant.
Oh, hang on, Warren, let's be honest. You were reaching for his spigot.
Yes, yeah, so I was reaching to drain him through his spigot. But yeah, it was brilliant, brilliant fun. Right, let's get Ben back on the screen. If you want to watch it, come on over to beastsofwar.com and check it out. Ben! News. Yes. Let's talk a little bit about news. What is going on in the world?
Okay, so first off, the Perry Miniatures brothers have been working again on overtime, it seems, and they have even more miniatures coming for us. So there's a new set of British infantry coming out for the 1800s, and specifically the 1880s sort of period.
Mm-hmm.
And they've showed us off a really nice piece of artwork, which will most probably be the box art, as well as some greens as well. So they've showed off the command elements and some of the infantry elements of it as well.
Yeah.
So these would be good for the Sudan and sort of Zulu period and things like that. So you could use them for that.
Awesome. So these guys would be the kind of guys that we could use in a Rorke's Drift type scenario,
Yeah. The other thing as well that someone pointed out for these guys is that there's no reason you have to use them historically either. You could steampunk these guys up and use them as infantry in any other game you might think of as well. So
yeah, they absolutely have that kind of Victoriana kind of thing going on as well. They might fit really well in Wolsung when you think about it.
Could do, yeah.
Grand adventurers in the southern continent.
Returning, you kind of returning soldiers. You could almost have them like they've returned from the Zulu Wars, right? And they've become possessed with voodoo powers, right? Oh, no, I think I'm onto something here. So they've become obsessed with voodoo powers,
the
right?
The guy sits and takes notes.
And they carry around kind of Zulu type spears, and they have a Zulu shields or Zulu kind of masks type things
Any
or
gourds?
A headdress. What?
Any gourds?
And a gourd, of course. Some of you guys might know what I'm talking about there. Justin loves a good gourd. So, do you know what? Have we spoken about that Wolsung is going to allow you to start creating your own characters and stuff like that?
Yeah, we did mention that they have a character creator in the works. I say in the works, it's not ready to go out yet.
Mm-hmm.
But I got to create myself,
which
I really liked.
Well, when that comes out, what we could do is to create kind of like a voodoo Zulu kind of
warrior guy.
Yeah. No, a team of those guys.
The important thing for the character creator is you're creating characters, not henchmen.
Oh.
Yeah. So you could add a little flavor to it with a character, but you can't do it with a henchman. I'm going to say that now because I spoke to Luke Ash at length about that. They're not doing that.
Mm.
Okay.
Oh well. Maybe a cool character in that style would
be
great.
Possibly.
Okay. Next up, we have some new stuff from Empress Miniatures, Ben.
Yeah. So we've been talking about Force on Force, and that's all very focused on modern combat, and that's what Empress Miniatures do very well.
Wow.
So they've been sort of looking for some gaps in the market to bring out new metal kits for, and one of the metal kits they're doing is this crew for recce vehicles, as you can see. I will point out that I'm not exactly sure where the recce vehicle is from, and who makes that, but the little
this
metal
is something actually
crew stuff.
British and American forces actually use.
Yes.
I think, if I remember right, I was speaking to John earlier, he called it the Lynx, I believe.
Oh, right,
I think that's what we call it.
Yeah, because I was looking at this, and I saw a sci-fi vehicle myself, but yeah.
Yeah. We also see some guys on machine guns.
Yes, well, these are actually not machine guns. These are MK-19 grenade launchers.
God, even better. Yeah.
Whole mama.
So, yeah, and these are armed by British and American troopers in the different pictures as well. So, you got some heavy support options and things for them there. So.
Anything else from those guys? No, that's it. That's it. Okie dokie. And then what's our final piece of news for this week, Ben?
So the final bit is River Horse have obviously been working behind the scenes on the Labyrinth board game, and that's slowly coming to fruition. And one of the sculpts that they showed off most recently is the sculpt for Sarah, who is the main character in the film. So,
well, let's get that up till we see where it's at. Where is it, Justin?
I've lost it. I'm finding it. Give me a minute.
Well.
Stop pressuring me.
Sculpting and painting was done by Johnny Fraser Allen and Jane Wenley. Who did which?
The sculpting was by Johnny Fraser Allen and the painting by Jane Wenley.
Yeah. Got it.
Okay,
This is a nice image of her in her sort of, as she sneaks around the labyrinth looking for her baby brother.
That is beautiful, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's really well done.
Someone pointed out that working that much detail into the waistcoat is going to be very, very hard. So.
There's certainly a painting challenge there. Right. Well, look, we've had Carlos in the studio.
Mm-hmm.
I had a chance to sit down with him, So we're going to take a quick break to tell you about some hubs, and then when we come back, we're going to have a chat with Carlos. We'll be right back.
Fight for the Iron Kingdoms as a Warcaster. Take control of the mighty jacks, arcane devices, and dark sorceries to bring the fight to the War Machine Hub on beastofwar.com. Keep your blaster handy. The West is a dangerous place. Fight to survive as men turn to monsters and the dead rise on the Wild West Exodus Hub at beastofwar.com.
Hi guys, and welcome back. I'm joined by Carlos. Yep, we have Carlos in the studio. That can mean only one thing. Good things lie ahead. Good things lie ahead. But I wanted to get a quick chat with Carlos to try and get a picture of the year ahead. Mm-hmm. As much as you know, anyway, and can reveal for Infinity of what we can expect. So
2016 for Infinity.
The plan, the vision of 2016.
Well, it's right now I have, there are certain dates that are really close now, but some other stuff is like in the mist, really.
Yeah.
Right now, immediately, February 22nd mm-hmm. is when the new ITS season happens, mm-hmm. and that's huge. I mean, we have a new winner miniature, we have a new pack.
Now, ITS, for anybody that doesn't know, is it's the International Tournament Scene?
Infinity Tournament System.
Infinity Tournament System. What am I International Tournament Scene in about?
Sounds
it sounds good, doesn't yeah. it? So, the Infinity Tournament System. Now, this is your whole supported, organized play kind of thing. Yes. Do you want to quickly describe your approach to organized play?
Well, this season has some new things going on. So at some point, the Infinity Tournament season begins. It will have a PDF file with the new missions for this year. And it will also bring groups of missions also. Mm-hmm. If you want to make a tournament focusing on destroying things, destroying your opponent, there are certain missions that will do with that. There are other missions that are more into taking objectives with specialists, mm-hmm. and they have also selected those missions. There are many things going on with the Infinity. In fact, we're pretty excited because this new season will have some new stuff. For example, some fluff events happening at some point. Mm-hmm. So expect at some point that the PDF file that we have now suddenly upgrades because something new comes and fluff happens and a new mission is added, and we're pretty excited about it. Also, the new winner new miniature, really.
Yeah.
And the new winner pack, we can have it right here, so we can unbox it. Uh-huh. I brought one with me.
So the ITS system, though, right, is let me get this straight. So if I'm out there and I'm a group of gamers in mm-hmm. a particular area, we love Infinity, we can apply to run our own ITS registered tournament.
Yes.
Among ourselves and stuff like that. So if we have a club, we can create an ITS tournament. Have it order the ITS kit where we get our prize support and stuff like that in it, but we can also then register the results so as it's all kind of sanctioned and everything
because
else.
There is a ranking. Well, there are three rankings: the USA gaming scene ranking, the Spain, because in Spain is very intense Infinity, and rest of the world. Mm-hmm. And when you win in a tournament, you have your score points, and your tournament organizer will report the tournament, and that will has its reflection in the ranking.
Yeah.
So a local gaming store can organize a tournament, or a club, for example, can organize a tournament just buying the tournament pack, mm-hmm. okay, or distributors, whatever, you know.
Yeah.
This is the classic tournament pack. This is the most, there are many different tournament packs. There are even virtual tournament packs and stuff, but I would say that this is the most popular because mm-hmm. it brings the prizes and the special miniature and all that stuff.
And so you can get this either direct from Corvus Belli or through a distributor
store.
Or through your store.
Yeah.
Okay, grand. Will we crack it open and have a look inside? So
before opening, make sure it's the 2016.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So it'll say Classic Tournament Pack Season 2016.
So the sticker
put that
is
over there.
Yeah, yeah, the sticker is the thing that distinguishes this from previous seasons, because we change the contents of the pack every season. Mm-hmm. New season, new prices inside, and now everybody's getting crazy about the new miniature. Uh-huh. So if you want the new stuff, don't get a previous season pack. Make sure it's this one.
Okay, right. Well, let's crack it open and have a look inside. So inside the box, we have the miniature. Okay. Mm-hmm. So let's have a look at that first. So Carlos, what is the miniature that's the top prize? So this is whoever wins your tournament. Mm-hmm. This is his prize. There's a cool little thing here. A thumbprint thing.
Yeah, only the winner can open the box. Yes.
Only the winner can open the box because I'm struggling. So here we go.
It's a Krakot Renegade, which is a new troop from the new upcoming book, Human Sphere and Free. Okay. Mm-hmm. And it's a Morat, but it's a Morat that has been in some kind of way humiliated and rejected by the Morats. Okay. It's a prisoner. And now he's a mercenary in the human sphere, so any generic faction can align this guy, okay?
And look, dude, it looks like Hellboy! It's awesome!
Yeah, well, when we get rid of the Morat of the usual long hair and beard, it looks like a little bit like Hellboy, yes. also has a chest mine, which is that thing that has in the chest, which is an additional template and has... also some close combat interactions. I want to spoil the rule because I will mis-explain it. Wait for the final text to know how it goes. Also, this guy has a metachemistry level 2 chart, which is awesome, something that will come with the new rules, with the new book. And, well, we can take a look at the miniature, which is lovely. This is the special edition only for the winner pack. Miniature. At some point, Corvus Belli probably will release an alternative version of this, but this one is the only for winners edition. Okay, this is the winner miniature. As you can see, also in the pack, it comes with the logo and a little patch.
Here is the miniature and the little bits. Base, you get the ITS tournament winner patch. You get the ITS tournament winner badge, and you get this Renegades badge as well. I think that's everything that's in there. So, any other pictures of him?
Yes, of course.
Just look at that.
Yeah, many people think that this is just a troop only for Morats. No, it's a mercenary, so there are more factions who can align him. I don't know if it will be correct for the fluff to have this guy fighting along Tohas, because Morats and Tohas hate each other, but it will be a nice addition to any kind of army, really. You see, we in the background we can see mobile brigadas from the Nomads, so...
What a cool mini.
Yeah, and the lighting effect that Angel made when painting the blade, that's extraordinary.
Okay, let's have a look at what else is in the pack. So, the other stuff we have in here is we have these are limited edition mission cards.
Yeah, those are. There is an alternative objective in every ITS mission, which is secure the HVT.
Yeah,
which means that your HVT is protected, and you have your troops or some of your troops around the enemy HVT. It's a secondary objective that you can accomplish if you're not able to accomplish the primary ones. You know. Apart from that, we have some camo markers there. Yes.
Camo markers we have.
Yeah.
Here. So these. It's up to the tournament organizer what way he wants to distribute these kinds of prizes, but there's three camo markers in there, a red one, an orange one, and a blue.
There are many different, there are one for each faction, really.
Yeah.
So there are like 9 different camo markers that you can find while winning tournaments and stuff. And the same happens with those, how do you call those?
Dog tags. Where do you see these? Yeah. So we have some kind of cool sci-fi dog tags here as well. Mm-hmm. So, like, you know, would you give these the kind of runners-up or something like that, or...?
It's just something for the fans, really, to have the dog tags hanging from their necks.
Yeah.
And they are, one for each different faction, mm-hmm. and one extra for Combined Army, because they yeah. have different races.
We also have some patches. Mm-hmm. So, is it quite random, this stuff that you get? Like, if somebody else gets an ITS box, are they likely to get different patches?
Yes, there are a lot of different patches, because they are the unit logos. Mm-hmm. So anything can happen then.
So, every ITS box...
It's a special, like a snowflake.
It's a bit different. Yeah, yeah, okay. Yeah. also in there, you get a terrain pack as yeah. well. And this one is the Aleph,
yeah,
I believe.
Yeah, FIS to scenery pack, that is the Aleph themed mm-hmm. scenery pack, really, yeah.
So, all the scenery in there.
Yeah, as usual, 6 containers, 4 buildings, and a gaming mat.
You get the code, which you can't see, which is probably a good thing, because you'll just go about and enter it into the system. what's in behind the code? What is that?
Just a little thing for announcing the tournament in the store.
Oh, so
really.
So kind of like a promotional poster, yeah?
Yeah, yeah.
And then finally you get the winner's certificate. So let me yeah. just get that out for you. And there is the winner's certificate. Mm-hmm. So ITS first place.
So again, the main theme under all these contents was to make give game accessories stuff that is useful for the player.
Yeah.
Not just hey you win and stuff.
So it's not stuff for his shelf. It's stuff for his army.
Yes, correct. Because sometimes we have winners that have won tons of tournaments and they were given a trophy.
Yeah,
and they were bored of having trophies because they have no usefulness mm-hmm. when playing. But camo markers, for example, is useful for them. The HBT card is something that they can use while playing. Mm-hmm. So that's what we finally end up having after discussing about the thing.
Yeah,
let's make it more useful, you know.
So the bottom line is. Yeah, the organized play is such a big part of the Infinity hobby now.
It's a way of supporting.
And we're not talking about, you know, hardcore tournaments. You know, you can have friendly tournaments and things like that as well. So, you know, if you're new to Infinity, you and your gamer group, or maybe you're not into the whole hardcore tournament thing, it doesn't really matter. You can still get a hold of the ITS kit and use it as a means of, you know, getting some cool prizes, some custom stuff, and... You will probably, no doubt, turn into a hardcore gamer after you've played it a couple of times.
Well, everything I get feedback from is ultra-competitive hardcore players, really. Those are in the forums that are making their own mathematics. This is unfair because in some kind of way I should have won this battle and stuff. Because year after year is getting more, you know, intense.
Yeah.
Talking about intensity related to ITS tournaments, on February 29th, mm-hmm. the sign-up period for the Interplanetary Tournament in Spain opens up.
Okay, there's a date for your diary. So the Interplanetary takes place in Vigo,
yes,
in Spain. Your hometown, basically, for Corvus Belli.
Yeah.
It's in a beautiful, beautiful venue that's overlooking the harbour, I believe.
Yeah, no, we have a lovely spot. We are pretty much trying to repeat the experience from last year because mm-hmm. everybody loved it. I mean,
yeah.
We have, of course, it's in August, so sunny weather. Lovely location with lots of natural light, lots of activities, lots of prizes.
Amazing food, by the way. Just,
yeah.
You know, for the likes of me.
And
how many players can you...
100.
So that's it. You've 100
spots. 100 spots that last year, like in 2 hours, they were, boom, sold out. And mm-hmm. So that is why, because we are advising everyone. We have even a countdown clock in the website of the Interplanetary because it's crazy. And... You know, last year we have American players, Polish players, Russian players. One guy from Hawaii appeared mm-hmm. in the Interplanetary. People from everywhere around the world, and they love it. and everybody wants to repeat the experience. So probably,
how many days does it last? Is it a weekend or?
It's a weekend, but some people, because some people come from, you know, from Poland, from Russia, so from USA, they come and stay like more than a week. Because we are Corvus Belli, we're fine. So we bring them to the HQ of Corvus Belli, and they see, and
so they can get a kind of a tour of the HQ.
Of course, of course. And they and they cannot resist, and they buy miniatures there directly, and we make a friendly price, and suddenly you end up with, like, looking for a certain miniature for this guy because he has come from Russia or whatever, you know. But they enjoy the experience so much every time we make this kind of stuff that, you know, I remember an American player before the event saying, that's enough, it's enough for me. I mean, even if we don't have a tournament now, he has seen the stuff.
Met you guys, So the sign-up is February 29th.
Yeah, correct.
You expected to sell out maybe in a couple of hours.
It's going to happen, yes.
When is the tournament itself then?
It's on the 20-something of August. I don't know the dates right now exactly, but it's in August. It's going to happen after Gen Con.
Yeah.
I guess it's 25th, 26th, 27th of August. Expect hot weather, you know, and
take shorts.
yeah.
Right, so that's February 29th. We've got to have Adepticon now.
Yes, Adepticon happens in March 31 to April 3rd, that first weekend of April. And Corvus Belli must be there and must bring all the stuff.
This is the first time that Corvus Belli have officially went to Adepticon.
Yes.
There's been Infinity tournaments and stuff there in the past, but this is the first time Corvus Belli are actually weighing
in. Booth. We are sharing a space with Warsenal and have a booth there, the official booth of Corvus Belli. I will be there. I know that Angel Giraldez will also be there around Adepticon and making masterclasses. And of course, I will be glad to sign your super new rulebook if that happens. and revealing stuff, and also speaking with American players, which is also lovely. And if I have the chance, visit Chicago, which is really close.
Well, stay tuned, because we have a series called Adepticon Talks, where we've been getting the guys from Adepticon on to tell us about what's coming up and stuff like that. We're going to try and get Carlos on and the tournament organizers for the Adepticon tournaments and showdowns onto an Adepticon Talks episode to tell us what's going on. So keep an eye out for that. That will be out imminently, and I'll dig his brain and get a little bit more on just what's planned. Obviously, after Adepticon, what's the next big one? It's got to be Gen Con.
Yes, Gen Con 2016. Okay, I'm going to reveal you what is going to happen in this year's Gen Con. I cannot reveal it.
So let me, I know that you are trying your damnedest to get something organized for Adepticon that's going to be very cool for the people that go to Adepticon. And you're also trying to do something uber cool for Gen Con,
It will be so cool that we will need to make a theme week for it. You know, it will be the super product of, you know.
Yeah.
Like, last year we have the US Ariadne Army Pack. Previous to that, Ice Storm, which was like a meteor thing. And we have a very high bar already, and we have to overcome that. So let's see what happens. But requires, right now, Corvus Belli is making the Human Sphere and Free book. And after that, we will have to put all our efforts into the Gen Con thing.
Yeah.
And after that, the Interplanetary Tournament, which happens right after Gen Con. And after that, Sea Monsters. You know, we don't know. We will have to sit down and make a lot of decisions there.
Yeah.
Because sometimes the activity, ideas, Interplanetary, Adepticon, Gen Con, is so much that it's like, okay, now sit down and take some decisions.
See where we go next.
Yeah. What next?
Well, stay tuned, because around the time of Adepticon, we've got some stuff going on. You will enjoy it, believe me. It's awesome. Carlos, look, thank you so much for joining us in the studio and give us an update on where things are going. We will head back. We'll tell you about some hubs, and then yeah, we'll pick up the show from there.
It's time for 28mm World War II action. Will you recreate history or reshape it your way? On the Bolt Action Hub at beastsofwar.com. From Viking halls to the cities of the future, terrain buffs will love our foreground hub. Watch gaming tables of all genres come to life at beastsofwar.com.
One of the interesting things for me in that interview was just how seriously Corvus Belli take the whole thing of organized play. Yeah. And I wanted to make that kind of our kind of main topic for this week, because it's something that has been on my mind an awful lot, actually, since the latter half of last year. Last year, we were looking a lot at recruitment and, what is the future of recruiting people into the hobby?
Yeah.
And I have some thoughts on that on tomorrow's XLBS show, where we're going to be talking about the new stuff coming out of Games Workshop that's going to be kind of more aimed at the very, very beginning level. So we'll be talking more about that tomorrow. But as the year wore on, my thoughts started to turn more and more towards organized play. And then when I had the chance to sit down with Carlos and have a look through that ITS box, you know, that they've crafted something very specifically aimed at creating and supporting and nurturing an environment of organized play. Mm-hmm. It struck me as, you know, it's something I wanted to kind of chew the fat with on you guys about. Now, if you take the organized play that we know of, and please, if you can think of something that we don't cover in this, post it below, because it's a topic that I'm really, really interested in.
Yeah.
Obviously, you have Infinity with the ITS.
Yeah, now, that the type of organized play for that is a competitive scene, where it is, okay, I'm here to win, I'm here to play the games, and I'm here to go home with the prize. You know, but there are other types of organized play as well.
Yes, well, you know, the ITS, you have the box that the organizer can buy and then use for all his prize support and stuff like that.
Yep,
but they also have an online ranking system.
Yep.
Where, you know, any game that you play is scored in that. Mm-hmm. But let's look at some of the others. Friday Night Magic, Ben.
Yep.
Yeah, big one. Keeps a lot of game stores open. That does. So.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But Friday Night Magic, I believe, even has a kind of like an online system where you can record.
It does. Because
it does. Yeah, yeah.
Whenever you sign up for your Friday Night Magic, you're given a sheet where you actually register yourself for Friday Night Magic. As long as you bring that card with you to any store for Friday Night Magic, you get your points in the system.
Yeah, and what do points make?
I'm not sure.
Ben?
Prizes.
Prizes, yeah?
Oh, we're doing that bit.
Yeah.
So
there was staying with sort of Wizards of the Coast and their Friday Night Magic, during 4th edition, D&D, the whole Dungeons & Dragons thing had almost Friday Night Magic type thing, which was encounters evenings, where you could come along with a character that was all sort of mostly pre-done, and you could just join in with an event and get going. So it was good for people who didn't actually have time to role play with a big group of friends constantly. You could just come and join in and role play. So they've done some very different angles on the whole organized play format and stuff.
Yeah,
so,
the past. Yeah. With the Magic the Gathering though, it's quite competitive as well, isn't it? You know, you know, both ITS, you know, certainly from the chat with Carlos there, you know, you got the impression that ITS is a pretty full-on competitive experience.
Well, then, like, if it's at that level, you're expecting your opponent to look at your stuff, know what it is, not really have to ask too many questions, and constantly be playing brain against brain.
I suppose one of the things that kind of caught me is, does it have to be that competitive? You know, like, are any of you guys running ITS tournaments out there that maybe aren't just so competitive focused? I know that there's a really strong competition and competitive spirit within Infinity. We know that exists.
Yep.
You know, but likewise, there's probably a lot of players out there, including myself, that we know these tournaments and stuff are friendly, but we sometimes more prefer a kind of like a softer kind of thing. You know, does organized play have to have a competitiveness at its core? Like, let me give you another example. The War Machine Journeyman.
Yeah.
I would say that qualifies as organized play, would you not?
Yeah.
Now, it's a kind of like a blurring of the lines between recruitment and organized play.
It's planned expansion in the way it works, because you're starting off with your battle box. Week two, you're adding this. Week three, you're adding this. Week four, you're adding this. But you're also getting points for stuff being painted as long as well. So it's encompassing more than just, I'm playing against you, I'm going to beat you.
Yeah. But there's that competitive element there as well, because you're trying to score points and score more points than the other people who have joined you in that particular tournament. And I have no problem with that. You have no problem with that at all, because I think that... the inclusion of painting and stuff like that kind of encourages you that wider aspect of the hobby. Like, Ben, you know, tournaments in the Warhammer scene and the Warhammer 40K scene, you know, Games Workshop dramatically changed
a
couple of years back how they approached tournaments and organized play.
Yeah, I mean, one of the big things from that, and I see it coming up a lot now in the way that stores deal with any kind of competitive event, was giving away prizes for people who didn't particularly do, you know, well in win-wise, but they won other ways. So they gained things like additional things for well-painted armies, for themed armies that had different ways of doing things. I mean, I know one of the ways that they're handling things like the new Hobbit tournaments and the new Age of Sigmar tournaments that are coming up this year is that they're throwing a lot more sort of like you don't need to win to be going up in the rankings kind of thing. It's all based around the points you accrue from good sportsmanship, from painting, from cool things that happen, from achieving objectives and things like that. So I think there is definitely a way to change the outlook on competitive and organized play events so that they're open to people who are really, really hyper-competitive, and also those people who are just going along, maybe it's their first competition, something like that. I mean, I come at this mainly from a card gaming point of view, and with Netrunner and Game of Thrones, a lot of things that we see a lot of stores do that have blossomed is that they make sure that they have prizes for people that do something strange with their deck, a little bit like someone doing something strange with their army, and maybe a sportsmanship award, as I said before. And I think it really makes people want to come back again and get going with the hobby. And that's, I think a thing that really affects people hobby-wise, in that if you're not striving towards something, you don't end up wanting to really paint it and things like that. So if you have these organized play events that you know are going to be fun to work towards, you're more likely to hobby and you're more likely to build an army and continue with the crafting of it all. So
Well, the key to me to organized play, and why I think it's something that every hobbyist should consider, is there's a very basic principle here. The more you play, the more you're going to play. And the one thing, and we see it time and time again. You know, we saw it whenever we ran the surveys and things like that over the last couple of years. You know, one of the number one requests of all gamers, or the number one wishes of all gamers, is I would love to get more games in. And the secret to getting more games in, believe it or not, is to get some games in, because we all have an apathy. A lethargy at times, something cool on the TV.
Does that then leave you saying organized play should be, I'm setting aside this day of the week to go to my club?
Yeah, well, if you think about Friday Night Magic, think about the success of Magic the Gathering, right? I've always kind of wondered is it one thing that makes Magic the Gathering successful? Is it an addiction to cards? Is it the collector's gene that just is triggered? Or
I think it's the collector's gene and the meta of it, building decks.
Right. So you think it'd be still as popular if they didn't run Friday Night Magic?
I think Friday Night Magic gives them an excuse to turn up and talk about the hobby. And I think that's one of the things that we really love doing, because we're so passionate about it. Turning up to these things like Friday Night Magic or whatever events that someone runs, and just being able to talk to like-minded people about your what you love is such a huge draw to keep playing the game, I think.
So. I have a feeling that Friday Night Magic is more integral to the success of Magic the Gathering than many of us realize.
They're guaranteeing players playing at least once a week.
I don't believe for a second that Magic the Gathering's success is based on one thing. If it was only based on one thing, then it would be replicable by other other attempts and other companies. It is a balance of great artwork, great underlying fantasy backstory, simple basic mechanics, but the cards expand it all. It's a bloody good game.
Yeah.
Blind buys add to that addiction.
Yeah.
You know, so there's a lot of things there, but I think by dominating and creating a dominating organized play network, I think that that is a vital aspect of the success of that game. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we look at the success that Corvus Belli are having with Infinity, I think, you know, it's clear to see that a big part of that is the creation and the nurturing and the support and the focus that they put into the ITS system, you know, by basically saying, we know that the more you play our game, the more you'll play our game.
Yeah.
So we want to make sure to give you as many opportunities to play our game. Now, it might sound really, really simple, but isn't it interesting just how many companies within the industry actually struggle to get organized play in place? Yeah. It's not a straightforward thing.
No. Yeah.
Well, it's like you said, I remember you mentioning this before, too much choice, you don't make a choice.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas if I have a choice on Friday night, I say, oh, that's Magic night. I know I'm going to play Magic tonight. I don't have a choice here. I've been doing this for 5-6 months.
Forming habits.
Yeah.
Forming habits.
Yeah.
Now, let's talk about, I want to talk now about, you know, it's all very well to sit and say, well, the secret to getting more games in is to get more games in.
Mm.
But let's talk about where people play games.
Okay.
Okay. So, you know, the three options as I kind of see them.
Mm.
One, stores. So you might have a really good store nearby who is encouraging and fostering gaming networks.
So giving you a holly home?
Together. Yeah. You know, giving you somewhere where you and opponents, not necessarily your mates, because you may not always know who you're playing with in a store, but creating an environment where it's easy for you to get games on.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. Other than that, you have, what, clubs?
Yeah.
You know, we know of some massive clubs like South London Warlords and so on. You know, so you would have clubs that potentially create this similar environment somewhere where it's easier for you to get a game on. But surely the vast majority of us play our games with our friends. And it's a social circle thing. It's a group.
Mm.
So how feasible is it in each of those circumstances to create organized play? Now, in a store, you have somebody kind of dedicated to that. They might be able to put in some prize support and things like that. Yep. It's in his interest to get people into the store and to stay involved in the store.
Yeah.
A club, probably not as often as a store.
Maybe so, but a club will have organized meeting nights.
Yes.
So you'll have that habit forming.
Mm-hmm. But gaming between friends, now there's an environment that's maybe a bit more difficult, because what you might also find among friends, I don't know if you find this in your gaming group, Ben, but we certainly find it here, is almost every week without fail, you know, on a Sunday, a little gaming group gets together here at BC4 HQ, and somebody brings a new game that we've never played before, and everybody wants to get on that.
Yeah.
Yes, exactly, yeah.
So is the same thing happen over there?
Yeah, pretty much. There's always a new board game, always a new miniatures game that comes up, and people go and play that, and they don't play the game that everyone's been playing for a couple of months and stuff.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So is it a case of another enemy of organized play is shiny syndrome?
Possibly, but what I find in our gaming club, I'll come in. Now, me, I'm not so bad. I'm pretty handy to the place. On the morning of it, I see who's coming up, I see what they're bringing, and I'm able to bring my stuff accordingly.
Mm-hmm.
So it's being able to network with your friends whenever you're meeting to game, up to the last minute to know, okay, I should bring this, because otherwise you'll bring half your collection with you and not use it.
Yeah. Well, if you were a new company, right, we've just closed a Kickstarter,
right?
We have delivered the products on time,
right?
And they're great, okay?
Yeah.
And people love it. We've realized that organized play is one of the cornerstones of what will make us a brilliant gaming company,
okay?
What would you do?
Create an official Facebook group and send it out to every single club that I know plays my game.
Okay.
And invite every last member.
To your Facebook group?
Yes.
And how would that evolve into organized play?
Because from that, people across the country can network, and we can offer prize support from that Facebook group saying, look, if you want to run a tournament, we'll give you prize support. You have to get X number of people, set up your event here, we'll authorize it, and off you go.
But set up the event where? Oh, on the Facebook group. Reckon the entire organized play thing could be done via Facebook?
I would say yes. You could get a very good start from that social networking
platform. So as a company,
social networking would be key.
Yeah. So we have the BJW games.
Okay. I'm just waiting.
All right. WJB
games,
not BJ games, right? So it's like, right. So WJB games, right? It seems to me that you're utilizing Facebook to organize it, mm-hmm. okay? But the key kind of driver behind it, you reckon, is the prize support.
I think having a system to say, look, here's an incentive for you to play more of our
game. And prize support is the incentive.
Bingo.
Yeah. Ben, what about you? Any ideas?
I think that prize support, as Justin said, is a very big key part of this. But also as well, almost like you put together a pack for the people running the event mm-hmm. to talk about how to run it, the kind of things that they might want to do, it, depending on sort of the approach that they think their crowd is going to aim for. Mm-hmm. So you could almost have this sort of ultra-competitive version of playing your game and then potentially maybe a more narrative thing, and you can market them as two different things, stuff like that. And also make sure that it starts off at a very sort of grassroots level almost, especially when you're starting out, I think would be a good idea. Mm-hmm. Just to make sure that you're not sort of you're not turning people away because I think, well, I don't have that many models kind of thing.
Yeah.
So just keeping it small and very focused towards either one way or the other, hyper-competitive or more narrative kind of thing. Yeah. I think it would be a good way to do it.
The other thing I think
and prizes. So yeah.
Is having things like the press gangers or the Black Ops for Mercs, mm-hmm. those mm-hmm. key gamers in local areas who you know are willing to go out to events and help with those events.
Yeah. And people who know the rules.
And how do you keep them engaged?
Offering discounts on my products.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you give them bonuses.
If they get more of my products, they have more to show people.
Yeah.
You know, so that's not a bad thing for me.
Mm-hmm.
Also, again, they get the whole accolade of, oh, I'm a press ganger. You know, I'm part of the gang. I'm one of the guys here. Mm-hmm.
It seems to me that one of the areas that I agree with prize support and stuff mm-hmm. like that. I think that any company that wants to create organized play can't sit back and wait for that to happen.
Yeah.
They have to be as proactive as they can possibly be.
But you can also find people who are going to be proactive because they're passionate about your game.
Yeah. I also think, though, you can't underestimate the importance of XP, of experience points and rewards points. Because it strikes me that having something like rewards points, and this is something that Facebook couldn't facilitate, this is where you start to go into, ooh, well, to manage this, I actually need a system in place.
I need to create a forum for that,
But if you take into account what ultimately happens whenever you start to award people points just for participating, is those points build up and people start to attach value to participation.
Mm.
Whereas if you're only providing prizes, what if you're one of these ones that is never going to win a prize? You're never bad enough to win the booby prize. You're never good enough to win the main prize. You're kind of middle of the road. Mm. And maybe you're a bit of a grouchy git. so most sporting is never going to be.
You would say experience with ranks. And whenever you hit, say I hit captain's rank, just out of the blue, would I then get, say, a 10% discount in the store?
I don't know what you'd get. You would have
like
rewards.
Yeah.
We talk about rewards, but let's put it like this. Mm. A lot of us play, used to play Xbox, okay? And, sometimes, you take Xbox, unlocking achievements, scoring gamer points.
Yeah, yeah.
The achievements and the gamer points are the reward in itself because it builds kudos.
Yeah.
But it only builds kudos if it has visibility.
Yeah.
You have to be seen. Mm. Yeah, people have to see what you've achieved.
Yeah.
So in order for an achievement to actually carry any weight,
mm.
But, you know, it's something that, you know, as an industry, we really have to you know, to pay more attention to this, because, you know, it's you know, playing a miniature game is not an easy thing, right? You know, it's not, you can't sit back and relax and play a miniatures game. You just can't.
You have to be in it and you have to be focused.
Yeah, it's not a relaxing thing in comparison to flicking on your Xbox or your PS4, kicking back and playing with a controller.
Yeah.
With a games console, you didn't have a rule book to read.
Yeah.
You didn't have to go anywhere. Yeah.
Your opponent's not standing in front of you.
You can play in your pants. Really?
I'm glad my opponent's not in front of me.
You know? So you can do all these things. You take a miniatures game. You had the rules to learn. You had to lug your army somewhere if you weren't playing in your own house.
All the extra bits, dice, tokens, templates.
Yeah, you have to get it all out, and then at the end of the game, you have to pack it all away. Yeah. There's a lot of reasons to be a lazy git and not want to play a game. Mm. And the game needs to be good. There needs to be reasons there to do it. And as an industry, we need to understand that every time somebody plays one of our games, we should kiss them. We should pat them on the back and say, thank you for going out of your way to do that. Because I know, in order to enjoy my game from BJ Industries, that you had to go through a certain amount of hassle in order to make that happen.
Yeah.
You know, and it's a lot of us, we don't consider that. We just think that, oh, we put out a great game and people just love the game. Yeah, people might love the game, but also remember the amount of hassle. Building, painting, learning, reading, getting rules wrong, and people making sure you know you got rules wrong, which is something I'm going to talk about tomorrow on the XLBS.
And getting people to play with, because if you're the first one in, if you're in on the ground floor of a game, you then have to get your opponents.
Yeah. It's not easy. Mm-hmm. It's not easy. You know, I applaud each and every one of you for sticking with this hobby, because you've maybe never considered it, because you love the hobby. We all love the hobby. But you have worked hard to get to where you are, and you deserve credit for that.
Very, very true.
We're going to take a quick break. After the break, we're coming back. We're going to have a couple of Kickstarters. We'll be right back after we tell you about some hubs.
Flames of War brings you the battles of World War II in epic 15mm scale. Go to the hub on beastofwar.com to find news, tactics, and tutorials about the game. Humanity has been driven from Earth, but now it's time to take it back. Join the Reconquest and fight the Scourge on the Drop Zone Commander Hub at beastofwar.com.
Okay, so Ben,
yes.
Kickstarters. What's going on in the world of crowdfunding?
Okay, so Privateer Press launched their big Kickstarter for their follow-up, almost in a way, to their adventure board game, which was The Undercity, which was all War Machine focused. And they are now looking towards Widower's Wood, which is their dark and grungy and bloodthirsty Hordes version of the adventure board game. So this is an awesome cooperative adventure game where you're playing as these wild heroes from many of the different factions in the Hordes world, trying to save their little corner of Imoran. I think that's the name of the continent.
I'm on
point. Saving their little point of their little part of the world from these evil villains that have decided to try and raise up these horrible beasties and try and take over everything. Because, you know, even the wild people who live in the swamps need to protect their homes.
Yeah. So, yeah. Now, an interesting, I don't know if how many of you guys had the same thought. I'm sure many of you did. Was why are Privateer Press kickstarting a game? Surely they can afford to make a game. But I know exactly why Privateer Press are kickstarting this game.
Okay.
Privateer Press have made some stonkingly good board games.
Yes.
But they're not making traction into board games anywhere near as fast as what they should be based on the quality of the board games they're producing.
Yeah.
So Kickstarter, they've said, well, we know where people are buying their board games.
Yeah.
They're buying them on Kickstarter.
Let's go to the market.
We can give them a cast iron guaranteed successful board game that they know they're going to get.
Yeah. And
gonna
be good.
In the process, give us the exposure that we need to try and lift the board game division, the board game aspect of Privateer Press, so that more people can see the quality of what we're actually producing.
So instead of actually using it for crowdfunding, they're using it for media generation?
Yeah, it's a marketing exercise.
It's and do you know what?
I know that there'll be cynics out there going, you know, a company like Privateer Press should never be using Kickstarter because, you know, that's not what Kickstarter was designed for. Do you know what? Whatever Kickstarter was designed for, it stopped being that a long time ago.
Yeah.
You know,
it's pretty much evolved now.
Yeah. So, you know, you go with the times. I completely applaud Privateer Press for this because it shows that they get it. Yep. They totally get it. The entire board gaming market that has started to move towards Kickstarter. The entire miniatures gaming market is starting to move towards Kickstarter. Mm-hmm. Kickstarter has been the biggest leveler of the playing field.
Yeah, it's an excellent that we've ever had. Platform as well.
Yeah.
Because so many people know about it. They go, oh, I want to see if there's any new games. Where will I go? Will I go to some tiny little forum? No, I'm going to Kickstarter.
Yeah. There's a number of things. You know, I know that there are reasons to dislike the Kickstarter model. Mm. One, it can be abused. Okay.
True.
Two, and I have seen it said, you know, they should do it the way they did it in the old days. You know, come up with a product and then go and see their bank manager. But I can pretty much tell you now that today could somebody create a product and go to the bank manager? Possibly yes. Do you want to know why? Because of Kickstarter. Mm. You know, until Kickstarter came on the scene, if you had created a miniatures game, right, and even tried to go to your local business development agency and see if you could get a business startup grant, they would have looked at you. You try going to a bank manager to say, oh, I'm going to create a range of toy soldiers.
However many hundred thousand.
You would have had no chance. Mm. Yeah. Today, you might just stand a chance to get something off the bank. Might. Because I think you'd struggle, even today, I think you'd really struggle to get conventional investors.
You'd have to be very clear and give a hell of a presentation to them.
Mm-hmm. You know, the first big, we are only starting now to see the proper investment channels opening up. Recently, we see how cool many or not secure some round Series A funding, okay? Mm. Basically, that's them starting to give up little chunks of their business in returns for capital injections that they can then turn into growth. You know, so it's given them capital to really ramp up growth, invest in areas, and speed up the growth of the company.
Yeah.
Because investors don't invest in companies that need the money to do what they're doing. They invest in companies that need the money to do what they're not able to do. That's how that works. So we're only starting to see the more traditional investment channels opening up. And the reason for that was Kickstarter.
Yeah.
You know, we can all sit and look at companies that come onto Kickstarter and make judgments sitting from where we are on whether they should be there or not.
Yeah.
But there's now thousands of reasons to be on Kickstarter, and they all vary. And here we see a classic example of a really well-established company that makes beautiful products, realizing that Kickstarter is not there for them to successfully fund the game. Mm-hmm. It's there for them to get their game in front of the people that matter.
Yep.
And Kickstarter is also full of sneezers.
Sneezers?
Sneezers.
What's a sneezer?
Sneezers are people that spread viruses. And if you want a game to go viral, you need sneezers.
Okay, now I get it.
You need sneezers to spread the viralness of that
game. So basically, someone will jump on here, jump in on the Kickstarter, jump onto the local forum, go, look what I found! Yeah. Ah!
Have you got a Kickstarter you can show us? Here, bring up the Widower's Wood Kickstarter and browse to the top, right?
Okay, so I'll scroll right
to the top. Scroll right to the top to show you something of interest here.
Okay. Da, 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 da.
This is a feature that on Kickstarter. Scroll down just a little bit for me, Justin, and click on Community. See that button there that says Community? Click on
that. Right here? Okay.
Right. This is a new tab. Well, it's maybe been there for a while, but it's a tab that I enjoy watching. Scroll down just, or take Ben off the screen. Take him off the screen.
Okay. Bye, Ben.
From this, you can see where a lot of the backers are coming from. So we know that this is quite big in the United States, 531 backers.
Yeah.
Okay. Scroll down a bit. and you can start to see the returning backers and the new backers. Scroll down a bit further, and you even start to see, you know, just even out of this, right? Stop.
Okay.
Stop. Out of these eight people, okay, you can already see one of the biggest sneezers, potential sneezers, in the whole thing. Have a look at Martin there. How many projects back?
646 projects. Wow.
Okay.
Wow.
And this, you can bring Ben back up. This is what I'm talking about. There are people who, if you can get him in, are fundamental. You know, because there's no way Martin has backed 646 projects
and not talked about
and not influenced somebody at some point. You know, it's highly unlikely that that's ever happened. You know, he's probably an influencer in all of this. And Kickstarter itself is an influencer.
Yeah.
So, you know, I am really glad to see companies like Privateer Press understanding this. They understand that the marketplace moves, it shifts and stuff. And right now, the focus is, and will be for some time, on Kickstarter, because it just seems to be where we get...
So they're targeting where their audience is, which is a completely fair way to do it.
Right. Ben, tell us a little bit more about the game. It's a new adventure. It's got heroes and villains, yeah?
Yeah. So the main sort of heroes of the piece are Skarg, Vaskis, Agata, and Olo. Olo is their leader. And he's the one who has seen that his village has been destroyed, and he needs to try and find a new way to get rid of these villains and band these people together from all these different factions to try and drive out these villains. The villains all look fantastic as well, I've got to say. And so they've got these really cool creatures and things that they're bringing out. All of these are going to be in sort of colored plastics and things, as you can see on the Kickstarter page. But they've also put together a little paint guide as well. So you can download that and look at the different ways they've put them together. So it's for people who... they've done the pre-colored plastics almost for people who want to just get into the game, get playing, and they don't care about that. But then if you've got the miniatures war gamers and the hobbyists who want to carry things on, you've got the paint guide and things like that.
Yeah.
You play through 7 linked adventures. Each of them works it out at around sort of about an hour long, although they have said that some of them last about 2 hours. So effectively, you do this over a couple of weeks, things like that. You don't play it in one big session unless you really want to marathon it, I guess.
Yeah.
But on top of that as well, they're also doing an expansion, which is called Dead Men Walking. And this adds, as you might imagine, some skeletons, zombies, bone swarms, and things like that. And they're all led by this nefarious necromancer. And this also has some linked adventures as well.
Yeah.
There's 2 3-chapter adventures in there for you to play as well. So there's loads of stuff packed into here, as well as all the stretch goals and things like that. Yeah.
I'll tell you what. I quite fancy the Widower's Wood Premium Collector's Edition.
It looks really
nice.
Yeah, with the wooden box.
Yeah. See, it's details like that that make a game really desirable, having that certain level of, what would you call that? I don't know how to describe it.
I guess you just call it bling, maybe?
It is bling.
Gamer bling.
If you're going to call it gamer bling, call it gamer bling, yeah.
It is blingy. Scroll down, because you can actually get a more close-up of the box. Yeah. It's got a kind of a leather exterior.
Monster skin.
If we zoom in, Justin, can we get a zoom in?
I'll try zooming in, but I think it might go off to the...
Yeah, it's there. You can see it a little bit closer anyway, so it's...
Let's see if I do that.
Yeah.
Not really what I want.
Yeah. But, right, well, how long has it got left to go, Ben? It still has 30-odd days to go, yeah?
Yeah, it's still quite a lot to go, but they're powering through all these stretch goals, as I say, so there's new heroes, new monsters, and everything coming along the way.
Yeah.
So definitely get on board this, see where it goes. It should be fantastic.
Yeah. Okay. Right, next up, we have a revolutionary miniatures carrying case. You'd wonder how revolutionary a miniatures carrying case can actually be, considering they've been around for a while now.
Yeah.
But this one is from Feldmaster. They've just launched on Kickstarter.
No, Indiegogo.
Sorry, Indiegogo.
Yeah.
The other Kickstarter. first thing, Justin, bring it up there, right, so as we can see it. Right, Ben, what is it? What is it revolutionary about this?
Okay, so think of this almost as if it's like a roll bar cage in a way for your gaming bag, in the sense that how it works is that you have the normal gaming bag as you'd imagine it, but the way that you put the models into it is based on this magnetic steel or sort of sticky surface platform that slides into it.
Yeah.
And then all of these models are protected standing upright by this roll bar type cage thing that fits around it, and it's very rigid and tough. And then you do the case up. So all the time that you've been playing your games before, you've had to put your models individually into each of these different compartments.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
With this, they all stand up, and you just take it out, slide it away, and then take your models off and get playing very quickly. Mm. As you can see, it's been mostly designed with sort of Infinity models in mind.
Yeah.
And that's the sort of way they're marketing it. So you have all your big tags and stuff standing upright in there and things. But yeah, looks really interesting there.
How much faith can we actually put in magnets? It's magnets that's holding the miniatures in place,
well,
yeah?
You have two options for it, because you have a magnetic tray that you can put on the bottom. So mm-hmm. you put little disc magnets on the bottom of your miniatures.
Mm-hmm.
Or they have a sticky surface one as well.
Yeah, it's an anti-slip surface,
and it sticks them to it.
Yeah.
And you actually give them a little twist and then lift them off. It's that sticky. But it doesn't leave parts of itself on your miniature. So there are two ways to do it.
Absolutely crazy.
Really?
Cool. Yeah.
Yeah,
it's in the video. Is it in the video? Can we clip a little bit of that video in just so
I
so
will
they
see
can
if I can get my hands on it. I make no promises.
Okay. If you're going to see it, you're going to see it now. I hope you saw it.
Okay. If you didn't, my powers of the internet have failed me.
Yeah. Right. So, well, scroll up till I see it.
Oh, scroll up
till I see it. Yeah.
Okay. So I will go back to the thing and scrolling up.
You know, having done a bit of stuff with the neodymium magnets
so
and
that's
stuff.
That's the shell.
Yeah.
And then further up, you see this at the front here.
Uh-huh.
That is your tray. So you'll either have your magnetic tray or you'll have your sticky surface tray.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You know, which I think is a very clever idea. They actually, in the video, there's a little segment where they actually put a tiny camera and a light inside the bag, close it up, and give it a good shake.
Right.
So you can actually see the miniatures being shaked and rocked around.
And they don't move.
They don't move. Although I will say, the guy is using Warhammer Fantasy miniatures on the big flat troop trays.
Right.
And they don't move. So there's a good surface area for that particular magnet to take hold.
Yeah.
It's certainly a very interesting way of getting around this problem of sort of time-consuming putting away models. Mm. Whether or not it'll take off as a big thing, I don't know. It might work for smaller sort of skirmishy type forces like Infinity.
Mm.
But for big armies, maybe not. We'll see. Okay.
Well, I actually quite like the idea. I didn't... You know, if the stuff is going to stay there,
yeah,
it seems like such an obvious solution, especially for some of the Age of Sigmar models, Ben. Have you tried putting them in out of a case?
No, because wings will break off, tails will
exactly.
snap off.
Exactly.
Yeah. So yeah.
I've just created an Age of Sigmar.
Sigmarite force.
They're not Sigmarites. They're Stormcast Eternals.
Stormcast Eternals.
How dare you? But my Stormcast Eternals. What do you call the ones with the wings, Ben?
Oh God. Retributors, I think.
Retributors.
No, Retributors.
I'm fairly certain they're not called God. Retributors I'll settle for, but they're the ones with the wings.
Yeah.
And I've been kind of just roughly weathering them up to make this kind of almost like a Hellboy-esque kind of clockwork Guardians kind of thing going on.
Okay.
With it really weathered, and they look a bit steampunky if I'm being honest, right? But every time I touch them, the wings break every time. so maybe a storage solution like this,
possibly,
where I can pop them in and they don't actually have to touch anything.
Yeah, well, you see,
because they're that fragile. They really are that fragile.
Mm. Well, you see, if they are stuck to the base, they're not actually going to slide about and hit against each other either. So you're not having to worry about your paint being chipped off or anything like that.
Yeah. Well,
an interesting one.
It's not up to us to tell you whether it's revolutionary. And guess what? It's not up to Feldmaster either to tell you whether it's revolutionary. Only you guys can decide whether it's revolutionary. So it's one I would highly recommend. Go across and watch the rest of the video, or all of the video, if we didn't mind getting in there. It's got about a month left.
Mm-hmm.
And I think at the very least, it's worth a look-see just to see what those guys have come up with.
Yeah.
Right, we're going to call it at that. Justin will be on in a few seconds to announce some prize winners.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and now remember, tomorrow morning we have the XLBS, the extra long backstage version of this show. We are still doing the Backstager Centurion Challenge. It's been fab. I'm really enjoying it. There's a load of new backstagers all joining. Basically, we're trying to raise some money to get another complete set of cameras to have two studios operating both at the same time.
Yep.
We estimated that if we could get 100 annual backstagers, so you join backstage and choose the annual option as opposed to the monthly option, we would tuck away all those annual fees, so set them aside to keep them separate to help us build up a fund in order to be able to buy the equipment. It's the only way we're going to be able to do it, guys. As I said, you know, we are at our technical limitations now. Now we just, all we can do is fundraise and stuff to continue expanding the amount of content and the quality of content that, that we can do. So we're very, very grateful to this set of Centurions that are currently signing up. It's been humbling. It's been absolutely humbling. People, we've even had existing backstagers donate annual passes, which you can do. There's a menu up there where you can donate annual passes, and we give those out to people, members who maybe can no longer afford it for whatever reasons. They may have lost their jobs or whatever. We don't want them to be... We want to keep them occupied in their time of need, rather than not occupied in their time of need. So we do keep an eye out for that, and we dish those out. So and any backstager that does that, you're a Centurion too. And one or two of them are actually double Centurions. So that's total power extreme.
I can think of a couple of them. That's maximum effort right there.
Yeah, thank you very much, guys. It is humbling. Right, we're going to call it at that. Justin will be popping up with his little bald head in a moment to tell you about some prize winning, some prize winners. So yeah, stick around for that. Ben, thank you. Justin, thank you. And we'll see you guys tomorrow morning, bright and early, over at beastsofwar.com. Until next week, have a great week of gaming.
Venture into the dangerous dungeons of Myth as a mighty hero and stand against the darkness. Visit the Myth Hub on beastsofwar.com and begin your story. Anime cyberpunk style meets skirmish combat in Infinity. Experience 8 high-tech factions and fight to control the human sphere at the Infinity Hub on beastsofwar.com.
Okay, guys, it's time to announce some prize winners. Our first prize was from the guys over at Massive Awesome, who were giving away a pro-painted version of Lee Kyung-min for their new game, Shattered Earth. Our winner for that is Hit Hero from Beast of War. So get on the site, get your prize claim in, and we'll see about getting it out to you as soon as we can. Our other prize was an epic one. We have a retail copy of the Mantic Games Walking Dead board game, along with a 50 quid goodie bundle that you can get. So our winner for that was Pirate Dave from YouTube. Get across onto Beast of War, mate. Get your prize claim in, and again, we'll see about getting out to you as soon as we can.